Welcome to another edition of Louisiana Business Spotlight. I'm Jeff Crouere. A great program lined up for you today. We're going to be visiting with outgoing Mayor of Kenner, Mike Yenni, and the new incoming Jefferson Parish President. So we'll talk about what's going on in Kenner, some of the challenges coming up in Jefferson Parish, a very interesting discussion coming your way. But let's start with some of the top news stories we're following right here on Louisiana Business Spotlight. New Orleans residents, their wages stagnated while their rents increased. And that's by nearly 12% between the years 2011 and 2014. And that showed to be the sixth biggest increase in that gap between rent and income in the U.S. And that's all according to a new study. The website is smartasset.com, and they examined U.S. Census income data and also rental listings from rentjungle.com to determine where the difference between what people are paid and what they pay in rent is growing the most. And one of those areas is New Orleans. A New Orleans-based substance abuse clinic, Network, has sold for big money, $21 million, and that's to a national operator. Townsend, which operates six outpatient facilities, one inpatient site in Louisiana, will now become part of American Addiction Centers, Incorporated. The deal includes $12.75 million in cash and $8.5 million in AAC restricted stock. Now, of course, our local economy is much dependent on the oil and gas industry, and what is going on with Shell is not very good news. Shell says it's cutting 2,800 jobs in response to plunging oil prices, and this cut amounts to 3% of Shell's global workforce. And comes after the company announced that it was letting go 7,500 workers recently. Now, the new layoffs bring the total to 10,300 workers that are being laid off. All of that is due to the price of oil in the U.S., which has now hit a six-year low in recent days. And finally, in the CBD of New Orleans, the State Palace Theater on Canal Street sold to a New Orleans-based developer last month, that's LC Hospitality Group, for $3.5 million, and that's the same price that developer Gregor Fox had paid for the property in August of last year. Fox is currently developing a theater in the Marigny area of New Orleans, and he sold the 3,000-seat theater to LC Hospitality, and they have hopes to restore that historic property. Okay, when we come back, we're going to be visiting with Kenner Mayor Mike Yenni right here on Louisiana Business Spotlight. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Very pleased to bring on now the outgoing mayor of the city of Kenner and the incoming parish president, of course, for Jefferson, Mike Yenni, joining us. And Mayor, how are you?
Doing good. Glad to be here, Jeff.
Well, let me just say congratulations. What a great victory. And we'll talk in our second segment about your next phase in your political career. But reflections now over the past 5.5 years, any sadness in leaving the position of mayor?
Well, you know, I look at it at 9 years because I held the number two position under Ed Muniz, and, you know, him giving me that opportunity really, kind of set my career in a good direction. And it's been a great experience to live, work, and play where you were born and raised and have an opportunity to change the community for the better and do things for the people that you live, your neighbors with, and live around. It's always been a pleasure to do that. I love being a public servant. I love working in government. I like solving problems for people. And, you know, a lot of people talk about all the time, you know, it comes up in elections, you know, you've never had a real job. Well, my philosophy is simple. This non-real job I've had has helped fix a storage system, and most people in the private sector couldn't survive without a storage system. Mm-hmm. We've fixed roadways to get you to your private sector job. We are working with the mayor of New Orleans for a regional airport to help your private sector job grow, to get you to other areas. You know, I think we've done a lot of things to enhance the private sector in the city of Kenner and in the region, working with the mayor of New Orleans and outgoing President Young and some of the council members in Jefferson Parish, along with the Kenner Council.
Right.
And we focused on those projects. You know, my goal was not just to sit at my desk and hope I could skirt by till the next election. It was to get out there, see what we needed to do to improve the city, get our population back up, attract those younger families, and do anything I could to not just change a city, but to change a region. And I think the outcome of the parish president's race was a voice for that.
That was a strong victory, and I think certainly it was a ringing endorsement of what you've done as mayor. Now, before we get into it, I mean, you mentioned about you're serving under Ed Muniz. Was he sort of a role model for you as you went in there, started as mayor?
You know, contrary to what my former opponent used to say about who my mentor is, my mentor has and always will be Ed Muniz. Mm-hmm. Ed is, you know, the Times-Picayune called him the white hat for good government, and that's what he is. I mean, Ed's always been for the people and making sure he's been a good custodian of the public's money. And, you know, working under him for 4 years was an experience that
ground running when you were elected mayor. So you knew it inside and out.
It was a seamless transition. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I was gone for 3 months doing the election at that time back in 2010. And, you know, I kept everybody in place that Ed had because I had helped hire them in 2006. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a great thing when a CAO can follow a parish president, much like Tim Coulon did following my uncle. Mm-hmm. You know, it was another seamless transition where good people got to stay in government. Because, you know, for those government employees that are good people and hardworking, sometimes elections have consequences. And term limits, how, you know, the public wanted that. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it also, not only does it put a good person out of elective office, it can also put a good person out of the number two, three, four position in a government, just because you want to have your trusted advisors with you. The person that you may be taking the office from may have some great people there with institutional knowledge, but it's a loyalty trust factor.
So when you started, of course, back in 2010, you probably had some of your top goals. When you look back, have you pretty much accomplished everything that you set out as your goals?
I think in these short 5.5 years, almost six, we've accomplished everything we set out to do. I would have liked to have been, I'd like to be here when a lot of these projects that are in their infancy get completed. Because I'm one of those that I don't micromanage, but when I see projects being done, I like to be on top of those projects and kind of put my own stamp on them to make sure it's what the people want. Sometimes architects, engineers, designers, landscape architects, they will do a certain thing because it looks good, and we want it to look good, but we also want to make sure it has the Kenner flair to it here, and it has things that we like to see in the city of Kenner. And, you know, knocking almost every door in this city twice when I ran for mayor, you know, I've gotten to hear the input of a lot of people. And, you know, we've done a lot of art projects, artscapes throughout the city of Kenner. And some people love them, some people hate them, but it gets people talking, and it shows that we're a community that cares about culture.
Right.
And, you know, the younger families are liking that. When I ran for office, I learned from Kenner, we have great subdivisions. We've got to cultivate those subdivisions back into neighborhoods.
Now, you talked about young families, and I know that was one of your goals in trying to attract more people to Kenner.
Absolutely.
Where does that stand now?
I think we're doing very well. I mean, judging by the amount of people that come to Coconut Beach, they're coming into Kenner, they're seeing what Kenner's all about. I've talked to realtors, they're very happy on the amount of younger families that are looking at homes. You know, throughout Jefferson Parish, and Kenner being a model of just the rest of Jefferson Parish, you have a lot of older housing stock. So how do you convince the millennial generation, you know, why rent when you can come here, renovate, and own what you've got? But you've got to stress that renovate, because sometimes these people look at the older housing stock and they're like, yeah, I think I'd rather a loft apartment with high ceilings.
Yeah.
But the potential to own is better than renting any day, in my opinion. And I think a lot of the millennial generation is going to realize that.
And then you have the fact, the quality of life, you have more safety. You have some other advantages that you don't have maybe living in the inner city.
Sure. I mean, you know, our Kenner Police response time, along with our EMS response time from East Jeff and Acadian, and our fire response time is great. I mean, it gives us a good mark on people understanding how safe this city is. And our first responders are excellent. They've done a great job making people feel comfortable in our community. When you look at our Kenner Police Department, we were just voted by two real estate sites based on FBI crime stats, not just the two sites saying, oh, look, this looks like a safe community. Based on the Federal Bureau of Investigation's crime stats, the safest large city in Louisiana. And that, I mean, that says a lot. And, you know, we have surrounding areas that are sometimes plagued with crime.
Sure.
And we've been able to combat the crime that comes out here because we have an unbelievable Kenner Police Department.
And that's usually the number one issue when you talk to people, and that is crime.
It is. We found in Kenner education actually outweighed crime.
Okay.
Because we were trying to reach out to those younger families, so we kind of polled them a lot. A lot of them all feel safe. In Kenner, I think people feel safe because they see the Kenner Police Department everywhere. Of course, I did ask for some millages. I wanted more Kenner police officers because I don't know what the future of Kenner could, you know, how this region unfolds. So I wanted to make sure we got our officers from 160 to 200 and they had the best equipment we could. The public, you know, undoubtedly said, nope, we don't want that. So you know, we've lived within our means and done everything we could through BP money, through grants, to make sure we give our law enforcement everything they need. But education was a big factor, and we changed that too by starting our own charter school, Kenner Health Discovery Sciences Academy, which is focused on the health industry because look what's happening on Tulane Avenue in New Orleans. And I am very excited about the explosion of Ochsner right on Jefferson Highway and what they're about to do over the next couple of years.
And a lot of those employees could live out here in Kenner.
Oh, absolutely. And we're educating tomorrow to get jobs here. And my goal is to make sure we educate them in health, you know, health and sciences, in hospitality, in those types of fields that we know locally we have. And our citizens should get the first right of refusals to jobs. But we've got to educate them in that field to make sure they can compete with people coming into this market.
During your tenure, there's been a lot of advancements and changes in Lake Town and Rivertown. So maybe we could talk about those two areas.
You know, I'd like to have done more in Rivertown. We've done a good job getting buildings back into commerce. I would like to have done a better job. It's very hard because of, you know, it's a historic district. We got it. The Lieutenant Governor Jay Darden got us put on the Main Street, which has been great for us. It's got, we've got some foot traffic. I mean, LaBella's is flourishing. The Crossing, the catering hall that they operate with another family, is doing very well. Jindusa's, I mean, Jindusa's is doing better than he ever anticipated. We have other business owners that want to come here, but the group that kind of oversees the development of Rivertown is focusing on foot traffic. What's going to get daily foot traffic? Not something that's just going to be a weekend place where people are going to come on the weekends. What's going to get people here daily? By moving public works and planning just down the street in kind of the Rivertown district, those employees come to eat here. Those employees come through Rivertown. Two of the greatest things we've ever done in Rivertown under my tenure and a little bit under Ed's with the Registrar of Voters office was that satellite office. And then the Department of Motor Vehicles has been unbelievable with getting people here. Because their service time here is quicker than going to their other branches. And it's kind of a hidden gem, but people are finding out about it. But they like the convenience and the parking and the walkability. And hey, after they sat all day in line for a license, they can walk down to Jindusa's and have a great meal.
We've seen some good things happening, and there's certainly the potential for more because this area does offer, I think, a lot of advantages that other areas don't have.
It does. And I tell you, moving Christmas Village down here has been a huge success. We were on the front page of The Advocate just the other day. You know, they got some great scenes of the crowd we've had down here, and it gives people that old town
and
feel.
And Deutsch's House.
Oh, let me tell you. The Deutsch's House get mad at me because I tell them, hey, if your building never gets built, I don't care because it keeps them coming back here.
Who knows when that thing is going to get built?
And they will tell you they have done better down here in the three weekends they've do than some years they had at the old house collectively. They have got what they've done. And, you know, Germans settled in Kenner, too. The Italians were more the vegetative type residents. The Germans were more into the horticulture, trees, shrubs, you know, those kind of things. I mean, Councilman Benzon, that's his family business. Was, you know, they started off a nursery, went to a florist, and you know, we have such a good ethnic background for those groups. Attracting a newer generation to experience everything Oktoberfest has is great. I mean, I'm sad to leave because I've pretty much gotten the tap in the keg down pat now. It takes me one hit where the first time I did it.
I thought you'd say the chicken dance.
No. I don't dance. But tap in the keg the first year, I didn't think I was ever going to get through that keg. But now I got it down pat, and it's been an honor to have them here. And they're great neighbors when they come. They want to make everybody in the community involved. They try to get the businesses involved. They don't want to inconvenience the businesses. Super individuals that work in that organization.
As we look at some other exciting projects up by the Lake Town area, certainly you've got to be excited about Coconut Beach.
Oh, Coconut Beach has been one of the godsends to us. I mean, the fact that they were palatable to coming to Kenner, which was a big move for them. You know, they had no location in New Orleans, but to try to sell them on the Kenner concept was very good, and they took to it like a duck to water. And land that we were basically paying to cut grass on, now we're making money off of from the leagues that they have there. And it's been a draw to the city. You know, Rivertown, as we talked about, it was like the historical part of the city. Lake Town is by far its future. And I wish we could have gotten the whole development you know, more on track while I'm here. The good news is my CAO, Mike Quigley, is staying in Kenner government. He's been at the forefront of every meeting, done a great job facilitating that. And he can make sure that the acting mayors between now and the new mayor coming in can make sure that project gets going. It's in its infancy. It took us a long time just to get the state land office to go along with us, to get it annexed into Kenner. There was a lot of things we had to do to make everything legal, you know, without just going out there doing it and then dealing with the consequences later. So it's on the right road. The investors are very upset, you know, they're very upset that I'm leaving and I'm not going to be here to make this happen, but they're happy that we've got the roadway clear for them. I mean, they can just start with what they've got to do, and I think that's going to be a win-win. Part of that investment group is already developing Joe Yenni and Williams Boulevard. Mm-hmm. You know, a tract of land I didn't know if it was ever going to be developed because I didn't know if it was ever going to be sold. And now we're going to have a very, very upscale strip mall location there. I mean, it's really, I hate to call it a strip mall because it's not your normal mindset of a strip mall. And all of the new developers in Kenner that have developed strip malls have really stepped up the bar. And what they've done is they've encouraged a lot of these other owners to reinvest in their properties.
Right. Two more issues as we finish up on Kenner. One, of course, the Esplanade Mall. What's as you look back on that, there have been a lot of changes over the past few years. How does that stand
well,
now?
Well, you know, right now, the owners of the theater, George Solomon and his group, have just reinvested almost $3 million into the theater. That's not even 2 years old yet. Mm. They've now invested. We're going to be the only theater in this region that has fully reclinable seats, push button, back and the feet. So you feel like you have a home theater at your house, but you've got the incredible 4D sound or whatever the technology
is today.
You
cannot get at your house.
Right, that you can't, would probably your neighbors would call if you had it at your house.
Yeah.
But, you know, so they've reinvested, so obviously that's helping. I'm sure with, you know, in a few days, the unveiling of the new Star Wars is going to show a little spike there on the amount of people that are going to go to that theater. Target is holding its own. Macy's has put more lines back than they've ever had before. So they're doing very well and looking to do some type of concept on the third floor. We need a mall manager that I think cares more about the mall. And I don't mean the specific person. I mean the management group that runs the corporation. I know it's something that they want to invest in. I think the new apartment complex that's going to be built on the back end is going to certainly get people over there. You know, I tell people all the time, at first I didn't want to go into the Dillard's Clearance Center that they have at the old Dillard's. It's not bad. Takes you a little time to find
exactly
what you're
there.
Looking for. Oh, look.
Great deals.
Sweet deals on some suits there, in my opinion. So, and a great, great selection of ties.
Yeah.
You can find some things that are marked off there that are full price at the other Dillard's because another Dillard's around the region sent it.
And this
it
is
there.
From a man of fashion an award winner.
There you go.
All right, and then the last thing I wanted to get your input on is the airport. A lot of changes there.
Absolutely.
And a lot of excitement for the future.
One of the biggest changes that this city and region is going to feel is the new terminal. I believe that if done correctly, this terminal can do for us what Atlanta-Hartsfield did for Atlanta. I really do. I think more direct flights is the key. I think having a mayor that actually now cares about the airport and really wants to see things happen to the airport, and I'm referring to Mayor Landrieu. I mean, he has really gotten involved in the airport more so than any mayor I've seen in the previous mayors that have worked with mayors of Kenner. And we've had a good relationship trying to work through any hurdles out there. Before, it was always no before the question was asked.
Right.
And, you know, look, we have it. We know it's here. Most of the residents that are living here now lived here after the airport was built. So if you move around an airport, you deal with what happens to around an airport. And a lot of the residents have come to that realization. Planes are quieter now than they've ever been. You know, the negative of the airport was all the buyouts that happened in the 80s and 90s. But we're over that, and we're trying to get those lands developed. The city council in New Orleans has worked with the city council and my administration to get those lands redeveloped.
So what is the timeline for the expansion?
I mean, you know, Mayor Landrieu was being very aggressive, hoping it would be open before he left office in May of 2018, but I think it'll be shortly thereafter that. But his fingerprints are all over that building, and look, I think we're going to have a world-class airport in one of the finest cities around.
And that'll
around.
Be great for Kenner.
Absolutely.
All right, when we come back, let's talk about Jefferson Parish and your new position and the goals for the new parish president. That's next right here on Louisiana Business Spotlight. We'll be right back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Very pleased to have with us outgoing mayor of Kenner, Mike Yenni, but incoming parish president of Jefferson. And of course, that's the exciting new challenge. And you're going to be taking office soon.
Yes, January the 6th.
Obviously, a lot to do. It's probably sort of overwhelming to go from Kenner, which is a small part of Jefferson Parish, to the entire parish. And this is the second largest in the state, isn't it?
It is. And it's quite a lot of square miles. You're going from a $60 million budget to a $600 million budget. You know, so it's a few more decimal points and commas. But it's, you know, it's about surrounding yourself with the right people to run government operations. Mm-hmm. I've had a great transition team. Dennis DeMarco was the chair of my transition team. Dennis was my grandfather and uncle's finance director. He was Tim Coulon's chief administrative assistant, and he's currently the registrar of voters. So he's been around all aspects of parish government since 1982. He gets it. He basically went through all the departments, made some great recommendations to me on the future of Jefferson and who should lead these departments. And we're going to focus on an economic development committee, just like I did in Kenner. Yeah. I can't take credit for a lot of the good things that happened in Kenner by myself. It was a collective group that worked very hard to set a goal and to achieve that goal, whether it was with charter schools, beautification. We focused on those. So we're going to do the same thing in Jefferson
Parish. But that experience you had sort of running the city is certainly going to help you as you transition to parish president.
There's not too much different about Jefferson Parish than there is from the city of Kenner.
Right.
I mean, you know, all the cities in the parish are unique and have some great things about each of them, but we all suffer from the same problems, an old infrastructure, a dwindling population, having more baby boomers than more babies. So, you know, there's trends we've got to try to change and deal with the trends that are here right now.
So during the transition, you've had regular meetings with the outgoing parish president, John Young?
You know, John and I have spoken multiple times. Mm-hmm. His staff has been incredible with working with us. A lot of good people on that staff, a lot of good people being retained. I mean, we're really, when it comes to department heads, only making about 7 changes to about 30-something departments. Wow. So that says he had some very good hiring practices under his tenure as parish president. You know, most of the people are pretty new to government that he hired, right outside, that weren't retained from the previous administration. So a lot of the executive staff members, of course, are people I feel very comfortable with and close to. You know, my chief administrative assistants, there's 6 of those, 3 of which are going to be new to Jefferson Parish. Mm-hmm. Steve Carraway, the former police chief, Dr. Diane Roussel, the former superintendent of schools, and Valerie Brolin, who was my IT and telecommunications director here in Kenner. And I think we've got to focus on a lot of technological changes in government because technology reduces costs. And that's what we got to focus on, and that's why I've made a lot of my decisions. My chief operating officer will be Councilman-at-Large Keith Conley, who unfortunately I hated taking him out of elective office because he's done a phenomenal job as a councilman. Like he says sometimes, he's surprised even himself. He's been a great floor leader to me, but he was a great counsel to me as my
so
city attorney.
So obviously the two of you have a good relationship working together.
Absolutely. So. We always have. I mean, he worked for me basically for 9 years, whether he was the clerk of court, the city attorney, slash acting code director. I mean, Keith's done everything possible under city government. And my deputy chief administrative assistant, Natalie Newton, will take over the role as deputy chief operating officer in Jefferson Parish, which is like the number 3 position in the parish.
So you're getting your team in place. You're visiting with the outgoing parish president. You're going to hit the ground running. So what are your top goals? And let's break it down in the west part of the parish and the east part.
Well, you know, the growth is unbelievable, the potential in the west. Mm-hmm. You know, the UEP Long has opened endless possibilities through that expansion. You know, that started under the administration of Tim Coulon, and it was just completed under the administration of John
Young.
In
our news stories, we just talked about a new development that's going to be bringing in maybe 2,000 acres of development in the Fairfield area.
Absolutely. Great concept. Want to do everything in my power to make that happen, especially with the redevelopment of Avondale. I mean, that's going to be a big one on what goes into that site, what we can do to improve that area and get those residents back. Because, you know, we lost a lot of people when Avondale broke up and they sent people to their shipyards in Pascagoula and, you know, up the East Coast.
So what can be done for Avondale?
You know, JETCO's a big player in that one. Yeah. You know, we've got to look at the opportunities. We know that there's issues with the facility itself. I think the Port of South Louisiana has some great ideas that we want to talk to them about. They have some major interest in it. You know, they talk about a container storage facility, which is great. Doesn't bring a lot of jobs. I would push for that if that's all we've got out there. But what other types of things can be there? I mean, in my opinion, you know, a car manufacturing facility. You've got rail. You've got the river. You've got endless possibilities to transport new vehicles to up the river, down the river, on the rails, off the rails. I mean, there's a lot of possibilities. So things like that, you know, talking to car manufacturers looking to expand.
How big is that site? I mean, we're talking,
you know, I don't know the exact
acreage. Massive.
Oh, it's
though,
huge. It's, yeah. I mean, remember, I mean, U.S. Navy ships were built there.
Right.
We don't have too many small U.S. Navy ships. So I say we, being a lieutenant in the Navy Reserve. And look, I'm more than anything, knowing about our aging fleet throughout the country and abroad, it'd be nice to have some new ships built there. But if that's not going to happen, what other possibilities can we do?
All right, and another exciting development in recent years, the Speedway on the West Bank.
I tell you, NOLA Motorsports is incredible. We've got to find other ways to make that, to get that out on the radar, because people don't know about it. You know, a lot of people still don't know it exists. And I mean, the people I've heard that have had just birthday parties with the go-kart track, you know, go-karts that go 40 miles an hour, which you won't find me on one, but I think it'd be fascinating to watch it. And I've been to many events at the clubhouse out there where you don't even look at the track. It has a very nice clubhouse that can host all kinds of different events. So it's got a great, it's changed that whole area along with the Churchill Technology Park where Jetco is housed and the Pat Taylor School and, of course, the TPC Golf Course.
Right.
We have so much right in that little area that really can change. And I mean, Senate President Ilario, along with Representative Billiott, and a lot of the legislators are working on some other things for Bayou Signet State Park and for the development around the Ilario Center.
All right, so now as we look at the in East Jefferson, what are you looking at as far as your top
goals? One of the first things I want to do is East Jefferson Hospital. Find out what we've got to do to stop the bleeding with the hospital. What can we focus on to make that, one of the good community hospitals it's always been. It was just nationally ranked with one newspaper, one magazine of the quality service you get at East Jefferson.
Right.
But we want to make sure that it's not losing money, it's making money or at least holding its own. So I want to work with the East Jefferson Hospital Board to find out if we need to talk to the state about changing some state laws governing hospitals. What can we do? I do believe what's happening on Tulane Avenue is going to stop some of the bleeding at East Jeff, because now you have more medical opportunities in New Orleans.
Right.
We were getting a lot of those New Orleans patients at East Jefferson. So I think that's, timing is everything sometimes. And I think, we're going to see what happens there.
Why is this drawn out so long as far as the hospital?
I wasn't there.
Yeah.
But had I been there, I think I would have done things completely in reverse. Mm-hmm. Knowing what I don't know about hospitals, getting a consultant in the first place to tell us what we need to do, what we need to focus on, not getting the consultant on the back end. And, I don't know what was communicated to the council. A lot was done in executive session. I would have liked to have seen more things brought to the public. There was supposed to be a vote of the public on the fate of our parish hospitals that we are stakeholders in. Well, that vote never was taken place. They changed that law to take that vote away from us. And again, the public may have voted to keep them where they are, and maybe that would have been a bad decision. So I'm sure they had a rationale for doing that. But I think being that they're our community hospitals, we should have been educated on why we shouldn't vote to keep them where they are, why we should have looked to lease at them. And if it would have taken 5 years to educate the public, I would say they were right on track. I'd say they probably did it very quickly. But 5 years and the public to be as uneducated as we are about it, I think that's a little bit of an issue there.
One good thing going in as parish president, you don't have to worry about a performing arts center that's not done.
Well, unfortunately, I hear there's still some change orders that are murking out there.
Really?
That's very upsetting to me. I'm all about theater and the arts. Love going to a good play. Love going to New York to see shows up there too. But when that happened, I would have probably sold the steel and given the money back before I would have put the parish into $25 million more of debt on top of what was already existing for that to happen. I mean, I want Jefferson Parish's Performing Arts Society and Maestro Asaf to have a great place, but if it doesn't even answer some of the needs and certain things or not the way it was supposed to be, and it took this long and multiple change orders, I don't think the public really wanted that. I don't think the public knew what they were getting into, because another thing that wasn't conveyed to them. Look, Senator Hollis did a great job getting that money for that facility, but we should have lived within our means. And if we couldn't have built a $54, $55 million facility, we shouldn't have done
so. So where it stands now is there's more change orders that you're going to have to deal with.
That's what I've just been informed early this week, that they're still in executive session on those. And again, something kept from the public, because there could be some litigation that we don't know about. And that's something I understand. They have to work through attorneys to make that happen, but that's going to be very, very upsetting if we have to spend more money on this facility.
Now, from what I understand, the money's already allocated for improvements to Zephyr Park, and that's going to be
Zephyr Park has a new 50-50 owner, one of the new owner not in Zephyr Park, but in the Zephyrs, who wants to really reinvigorate the team and really explain to Southeast Louisiana what baseball is all about. Mm. A lot of people say we are a football city, and because of the Saints and the rivalry of the right. Saints and being a stone throw from LSU and having Tulane and again, a lot of people have so many options with the former Pelicans the Hornets now Pelicans. Mm-hmm. You got a lot of sports options in this region. And anything I can do as parish president to help make the Zephyrs a success, I want to do that.
I think that park is going to be upgraded, correct?
Absolutely. They're going to do some things to it. And the new owner, part owner in it, said he has never, he's seen it's a great facility they have. There's some facilities around the country that don't look this good. One of the ones he owns right now was built under FDR. So we're going back 60 years. So we have a great facility right there on Airline, and I think it needs to be marketed better. And I think other events are going to happen there on top of baseball. Right. They want to do concert series. They want to get people to feel comfortable going to that park. A lot of baseball parks, any New Yorker will tell you, they're like cathedrals to them. They go there for all kinds of events outside of baseball.
And that's all good economic development, isn't it?
It is.
Bringing in dollars
And again,
to the
you do things, yes, grandparents can take their grandkids to the park, but you also, for that younger generation, be great to have some fathers take their sons. Trying to get that group motivated to be, to be a part of those kind of events.
So as you look at all the different things you have to accomplish as parish president, what is going to be your number one goal?
Well, definitely trying to do what we've done in Kenner, not just changing a city, trying to change a region. Mm-hmm. Changing the parish so that people understand what Jefferson's all about, what has kept a lot of people here in Jefferson. We're not just a suburb anymore. Like Jefferson at one time back in the 60s, Jefferson Parish was the fastest growing, I'm going to say county, even though it was a parish, but it was known to be the fastest growing county in the country. And it grew, fast. And yes, we have some infrastructure repairs that have to be done.
Sure.
Because you can't have third class sewage and water systems and expect to have a first class city. Mm. So, there's a lot of things that have to be repaired because we are an older parish.
And that growth has stagnated in recent years.
It has. And we need to get it back up. We need to make sure, yes, we're a good neighbor to New Orleans. And look, if New Orleans is number one, Jefferson Parish needs to be 1.5.
Yeah.
Not number two. We need to make sure we're selling ourselves so that younger generation says, wow, they got, they're going to have a good education system. They got a great sheriff's department. They've got, a user-friendly government. I want to make sure we can be as technology-friendly with the public through apps, through Facebook, and those types of means so that they know what their government's all about.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure you're going to be hitting the ground running.
Absolutely.
Very exciting time for you. Let me just congratulate you again.
Thank you.
Wish you the best.
Jeff, never in a million years did I think I would be able to accomplish what my grandfather did, going from mayor of Kenner to president of Jefferson Parish. I didn't know what my future held after mayor. Yeah. I was so honored that the people elected me mayor, and I've done a great job. I hope they don't feel they're too upset with me that I'm leaving them, because I'm not. I'm still going to be a resident of Kenner. I'm still going to be very concerned about what happens to the city of my birth, and hope it's the city of my death, and I don't ever want to go anywhere but the city of Kenner.
And you're not and leaving, you're just moving down the street.
Exactly,
really.
And I want to make sure my daughter grows up in the same community I grew up in. When my wife and I just recently bought a house not that long ago, we went to the same street I grew up in. So I'm happy to be in my old neighborhood, and I want her to experience everything I've gotten to experience in Kenner and in Jefferson Parish, and hope that her family stays here just like mine is.
Well, I certainly appreciate you coming on the program.
My pleasure.
And we'll be watching and invite you back on regularly.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Our incoming parish president, Mike Yenni, outgoing mayor, and so much we're going to be following right here on Louisiana Business Spotlight. We'll end the show with some good news stories. That's next, so keep it right here. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Now time for some good news in our local business world. Envisioning what amounts to a new town of 20 to 30,000 people, a Louisiana real estate developer is now taking a, quote, serious look at building a 2,000-acre residential and commercial project on one of the largest remaining empty pieces of land in Jefferson Parish. Southern Lifestyle Development is eyeing this huge chunk of the approximately 9,000-acre Fairfield area between the south of Avondale and West Wego. The Jefferson Parish Economic Development Commission, JEDCO, recently announced that the 2015 Small Business of the Year was awarded to Boscali Foods Incorporated, an iconic food manufacturer headquartered in Jefferson Parish. They were founded in 1992, and the family-owned business produces olive salad and other related products distributed to grocery stores all across the country. At the same time, Kenner's chief administrative officer, Mike Quigley, earned JEDCO's Business Retention and Expansion Award. Congratulations to both. And finally, the 93-year-old grocery chain Langenstein's announced that it will open its third store in River Ridge as the anchor of a revamped shopping center. Now, the grocer will occupy more than half of the space at the 47,000-square-foot Langenstein Center at the intersection of Jefferson Highway and Suave Road. Now, the developer, Paul Dorsey, acquired the property back in June of last year for $2.6 million from the longtime owner of the mid-century site, and now good things are happening there. So if you have any ideas or comments about topics or potential guests, please contact me. You can reach me at jcruere@gmail.com. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Jeff Crouere, and I'll see you next time for another edition of Louisiana Business Spotlight.